Very good morning to all of you. Welcome to today's session on the future of training industry during and post COVID era. Why I have initiated this particular program is we all know that every business has got impacted, and now people will have a priorities, and the trainers who are into classroom may not enjoy like earlier because social distance is the order of the day. And it's not just in India, it is everywhere on the globe. So now that we can see the last 2 months, people either have done free sessions online or they have done some sessions, paid sessions. So it is now not going to be the same. It is going to be in dilemma. So now it is not fully locked down, it is not fully open. In this situation, people are not clear because the priorities are when they are at home, they have nothing else to do. Either they watch a free session or a paid session. They make use of that time. Now they are in a more hurry. It is actually a kind of a survival, or they have to revive their business or their life. So they may not look at you until yours is something related to sales. So I feel there are so many people who are into training, who are into coaching, who are into professional speaking, who are into different fields except psychology, because I feel psychology is going to do a great job now, because that is going to, like doctors, they are going to help many people. But these fields, a proactive fields like human potential development, so these professions, people have become professional, because recently there are a few sessions I have attended, like Murali Sundaram and also Mr. Rajiv Talreja, also joined in their community called Game Changers Community. And he said there are four categories basically into this training division. That is, one category is called strugglers. They are professional in what they do, and they do not know how to market. So they struggle, but they did some program, they got some certification. They are under the illusion that they are trainers, they are speakers, or they are coaches. They got certification, but they have not yet mastered it. So they struggle. And there is one area they have mastered the field, but they do not earn much income. So they are survivors. Sometimes they get job satisfaction, sometimes they get job satisfaction, but it is a survival. They will not grow, but sometimes the guilt will haunt them, because you tell them to grow, you tell the, you, many people will really flourish because of your speeches, your coaching and other thing, and where you struggle, you survive. So you will have to have the music. So that is another way. There's a third category, he called it as scamsters. They know how to market, but they don't have the stuff. So they know how to sell it. So, and these people are also there in the industry. And there's another category, they are masters at what they do. They're authentic, and they also know how to market. So that we help you, that's what they say. And Rajiv Talreja started a community called Game Changers Community. And similarly, Murali Sundaram and Sudhir also started an online program. I found it very useful on how to market yourselves if you have the stuff. So, and definitely I can tell you there's a golden period for human potential developers now. But the only thing is you have to understand who you are, what is your niche market, and focus on that. Don't be a generalist now. And because I always believe that entrepreneur mindset is needed than any time now for the professionals. And if you don't have the business mindset and entrepreneur mindset, you will only hoping that customers will be coming to you. And it is not happening that way. And it is either out of sight and out of mind. You have to know how to sell yourself also, apart from being an authentic and master at what you do. So with this context, I'll introduce my speakers of the day. The leaders of today are Mr. Ram Jaldurgam. He is a learning and development head in Hetero Drugs Limited. He's an executive coach. In fact, he's a celebrity coach. And he's also a psychotherapist. And he has also pursuing his PhD. And he handles nearly 300 trainers in this company, because Pharma is a company which training is a mandatory, whether technical skill or a kind of a soft skill. And he has seen every kind of speaker and trainer in his organization. And coming to Akila Ramesh Garu, so we only know Ramesh because I found this in LinkedIn, that the surname. And I know him as an HR for the long time. I think they invited me first time to Hyundai Motors in 2016 for all over India, the leaders, including Indians and Koreans. And the second time, I think 2018, they called me when they they are implementing their values in one of the value celebrations of people. About 750 people, about 3-4 sessions I've given in that company. So though they love me, I'm the most preferred name. Why don't they call me every year or every month? So I want to ask him today. Ramesh Karu is, yes, sir. Thank you, sir, Ramesh Karu. And he has totally has got a 24 years of experience in HR. And he doesn't look like 24 and he has experience of that. So let us see. Hear from this leader today, and he's also into admin now. So GR Reddy, so I have no words for him. If at all, I admire a man in HR, so it is GR. And admire him in every dimension. As a father, he is contributing a champion to this country. And Meghana Reddy, she's in the making. She also participated in Rhythmic Olympics in Commonwealth Games. And the kind of commitment, the kind of simplicity, every time you see him, normal, Sitta Prajna. If at all the Sri Krishna says Siddha Prajna, you can see him. So he doesn't like to get motivated, neither he motivates people. So I think last 15 years, our conversations are wonderful. And thank you for being in our life, GR. So GR is a founder of Husys, and about 100 plus people are, his team are working with him. And many people became entrepreneurs in HR. He's a pioneer of HR outsourcing business in India. Let's listen from GR today, and he's a first listed HR company in India. And Sri Anjigari is a I think he first saw me in Ultratech Cement when I have done nearly about 5 years training to that company in Tadipatri, and also different places of Ultratech Cements I've done. And he silently observed me that time. I think he's not into full HR head, but he's into some department related to HR. So when he became HR manager at Ramco Cement, invited me, and the top management have done the program, including the vice president, Mr. Gopal Krishna, said that. So I never listened to such a kind of program, highest rating. So twice they called me to that company, still that friendship is going on. So after that, he went to the Sabre Mills. And the advantage of having a HR friend is, whenever they shift companies, I get business. So I wish that they shift as often as possible. And they invited me to Sabre Mills twice. And then he shifted to another company, and every time he changed the company, he asked me as a friendly advisor, this company, I have 2-3 offers, which company to join? I feel honored that an HR manager seeking my idea, I'm seeking my opinion about what is wise for him at this point of time. And I can see that 2-3 companies he joined, and some company I said immediately relief from them, and he left that company, and he got an offer from Mahindra and Hero Motors. And Hero Motors he got actually Nellore, but due to political situation, that company has not yet launched there, so he had to go to Delhi. So that gentleman, I see that he is such an authentic man. But language-wise, he's a simple man. He don't think that he's an HR manager, but performance-wise, he's world-class. I can see that domain expertise in him. So he's also joining with us today. And thank you. With this, I want the panel to start. And to begin with, Sri Ram Jaldurgam. And I want you to co-lead with me today, Sri Ram Jaldurgam. It's over to you, dear Ram.
Sure, Venu. Thank you so much for the so nice introduction. I am pleased with your introduction about all the other co-panel members, meet them on this platform. Today, in fact, every industry is having this kind of discussions, what is our post-pandemic job. Today, it is officially, hello, I hope you are able to hear.
Yeah, we can hear you, Ram. We can hear.
Now, these are the Black Swan days. And these are officially called DUCA D. You know very well UCA days we are already facing and we are experiencing every day. DUCA D is actually an official nomenclature which has come now. We need to understand D is the diversity, another D is the disruption. Disruption, UCA, diversity. So UCA is there anyway. It is already volatile, uncertain, chaotic or complex, and ambiguity is there. So in these days, everybody is under confusion, but one thing that everybody has got one clarity is that all our past experience and past job and our past expertise is not going to work anymore for future. You will have to change your business model. You need to change the skill set of the employees. The same job role will not be there, but the person will be there in the organization. You will have to relook into the job description. For example, if a restaurant is there, there are servers working in the restaurant serving the food. Today, you will have to redesign their job role. They need to learn how to drive a vehicle, go to a customer and deliver food. If you have in the organization drivers, a real estate company need to train the drivers to operate even the other machines like excavators. So what do? You need to redesign the job. We have a lot of complexities are there. In fact, it is not just directly a training. Before that, how HR is looking at it? What is the human resources plan? And how organization management is thinking now? These are the questions which are haunting every HR professional. At the same time, employees also. Today, though HR is not clear what we are going to do in future, but HR, it's a prime responsibility of HR to give confidence to the employees and as well as organization. And also, it's a prime responsibility of HR to take care of the individual health of every employee. At the same time, they have to take care of themselves. HR will have a lot of challenges that they cannot sit at home saying that I'm staying at home, but they also need to track what is happening in the organization. And in these challenges, let us hear other people in the panel members. What are the changes that they have observed and how are they experiencing and what is their thought process? So let me just ask this to GR. Probably GR into, maybe it's not operational, HR is a consultant. He must be hearing the voices of many clients. And what is the status and how is the demand of hiring people in fact now? GR, what do you like to hear?
Yeah, so I think you are asking for a specific question on the hiring, what's happening right now.
Yeah.
So I think I have started my business when Twin Towers fell. So, you know, I started in a distress anyway, and that's the opportunity that I see. So even if you ask me at this point of a time, I would still say that there are more number of people hiring than firing. Okay. Yeah, we do service both. For large companies, when they terminate, we do help them with outplacement, you know, in terms of career coaching and all that. Mm-hmm. And which is on the rise, actually, in the last 20 days, we have been handed over around 500 people to us from different companies. So you can imagine that is one. But on the other hand, definitely a lot of these MSMEs whom we are dealing with, we deal with only with MSMEs. A lot of them are actually literally on a hiring spree right now. So many of them who are, good part that not many SMEs actually have terminated employees. You know, that's the beauty of MSMEs, which I always admire and which I'm lucky that, you know, I'm part of it. And I feel that that's one of the biggest opportunities that I would like to talk as we go on into the discussion. So, but right now, yes, there is a whole lot of hiring happening, market opening up, and people are really looking to hire people. But also one trend that I see that not necessarily a permanent jobs as such. So, you know, what we refer to as a gig workers in terms of the specific skill for a shorter duration or maybe for a longer duration, you know, both happening. And a lot of demand that I see the business that I'm in extremely from the MSMEs across the world are actually looking to hire into India. And that is actually on a huge raise at this point of time. So specific to the hiring realm, I responded right now.
HR, GR, in fact, this is very motivating and interesting. One signal, that strong signal you have given is that it's more hiring is happening than firing. We do not know across the industries is the same trend or is there any different experience from the other industries? I would like to ask Ramesh, what's the trend that you see and as a HR admin, what's happening?
Well, thank you. First of all, good morning all panelists, and thank you very much, Mr. Venu, for inviting me to the panel discussion, and I'm honored to join this panel. And to answer your question, Mr. Ram, actually, I agree with other gentlemen. Like, you know, hiring is going on. Like, you know, even if you look at the bigger picture, this is pandemic is only 2.5 years at this moment. But a lot of companies looking at this, you know, as an opportunity rather than like, you know, worrying about the future. And this is the time they have to invest on the, you know, people. So that's what people is actually like-minded, and actually people are interested. People are motivated. They don't require additional motivations, and it's just a hit the bullseye. So that's like look at organizations. So hiring, definitely it's like in the on the cards in the maybe third quarter we are going to start hirings. Especially it's like again segment basis. In the segment, sub-segment also is like, you know, for example, like, you know, automobile, I consider I backed on automobile. So I look at automobile, like they look at the research. In the research, this is an investment to hiring people and for a longer time. And in the sales force and other, you know, plant operations, I think they do little bit wait and watch, and probably maybe third, fourth quarter. So they started hiring, but it definitely is the positive side. Yep.
So I understand a lot of organizations are very futuristic and they are looking forward for a lot of opportunities in future. Very nice. I appreciate other panel members who open their camera so that we will get a hint that they are active. Then we can pose a question to them.
Ram, just to add some value here.
Yeah, please.
We had done the same program probably 2 months back. It is more of a perceived notion that, you know, I think we need to stop everything and, you know, let's wait for it. I think we are at a lockdown open, that gates have opened. I think the perception and the ability to articulate that, you know, we will go full throttle is happening. That's my guess now. That's the confidence, that's the ease at which that we are speaking today.
Yeah. So nice. In fact, I just wanted to ask the training fraternity here, those who are in the panel. In fact, having an idea that we are going to hire, in fact, a lot of organizations are going to hire people in future, for future. And what are the new skill set that industry is expecting or this world is expecting? What are the new capabilities that we require now post-pandemic to fit into any job? What are the basic things that we need to now adapt and learn to fit into the new world, new norm? I just want to respond to any of the panel, training industry panel members. Venu?
Yes, Ram. So if you ask you have...
Any other panel members?
Mr. Anjaya is not yet joined. He has some technical issues. He would join.
Fine.
Right now, you are the three panel members.
All right, right. So, you know, what I'm saying, it is a generic, I just wanted to share. There are a lot of paradoxes that I have seen now. The paradoxes are that take care of yourself, but take care of the employees. It's a big challenge. Maintain social distance, connect with the customer. It's a paradox.
Yep.
These many paradoxes are, first is with HR on training people. For example, train people, training industry, if you have to train people, but technology has got limitations. And now our training, whatever ILT, instruction-led training programs, I don't think that now it will run like this. For example, when you are accommodating 30 participants in one room, today, first of all, people are preferring e-learning, online learning, and classroom programs are a biggest challenge. Even if you maintain social distance, keeping them for an entire one day, 15 people, now people are not imagining that kind of training. So trainers, I do not know if any trainers are there, as freelancers, how do they look at the future? Because today most of the industries don't require any motivational training, and only what you require is that you require an assurance from the organization management and HR that don't worry, we will improve your capabilities and competencies to fit into the another role if not this. So whatever the competencies required for you for the role, we will develop those competencies. This kind of assurance and confidence is required than the motivation. There are many new competencies that we need to improve. So Mr. Ramesh, what do you think that, what are the new competencies that you looked at and that people need to improve?
Actually, I'll answer the question a little later. I just wanted to give a background about the competencies actually. So, like, you know, 5 years before, you can say like 2015 around. So actually, some of the largest companies started, you know, shifting their training modules, like training, you know, framework, in fact, vision. They've changed towards the industrial revolution side. So if you look at bigger picture, we are already in the industrial revolution 4.0. So the biggest point is like digitalization and automation, artificial intelligence. With respect to artificial intelligence, the training profile is become more virtual. See, I'll just give a, it's like, you know, just a thought I just wanted to share with the, all the members. Like, imagine 2025. So the you will find a artificial intelligence person, like, you know, he gives the lectures what the customer want, what the learners want. So that would be the future. Like a lot of, you know, startup companies started working to develop their models, like training models, in the industrial revolution era. So unfortunately, this, you know, pandemic come little faster way. I don't say that, like, so otherwise we are anyway shifting the entire, you know, things process maybe little later side, but now we don't have option. As an industry, we have to rush and we have to come fast and do the like automation side and more. So coming back to the competency side, so in the past, I think a lot of bigger organizations started developing their competencies. In a big picture, you have a core competencies. Generally, the company runs on their certain core values. So those kind of, we can say, competencies, like, for example, customer is my, you know, God. So I want to develop my, you know, competencies around the customer satisfaction, customer needs. Simultaneously, people is my, you know, like my endpoint. So I want to develop the competencies to develop the people. So these kind of things were in the core. Every company have their own vision and mission. From there, they derive some values. So from there, and this is one way, it comes in organization culture. And another part, improve the people's, like, you know, job competencies. Like, you know, how do I perform my job? For example, I'm an accountant. What is my competency to do my accounts? Like, attention to details. I should read the numbers perfectly. And I should do the calculations perfectly. That is my primary, like, you know, as an accountant, primary competence. So similarly, it has been identified a job-based competencies and try to link the your training programs to the these competencies and deliver them. That's absolutely need for the particular position. Suppose, for example, HR manager. HR manager, what they're supposed to have? They're supposed to have a negotiation skills, people skills, like people, you know, kind of empathy. Empathy is one of the core competency HR professional must have towards the people. Simultaneously, if you take a law or maybe advocate who done the some kind of, you know, he has to be more detail oriented about the certain jobs he's supposed to do, how to make his case.
Mapping,
exactly. So those kind of things is comes under job competencies. See, if I look at the trainer, what are the trainer's competencies? Like, you know, he's supposed to be public speaking, presentation skills, and there should be understanding about what exactly current industry is happening.
Suppose what not? People expect everything in trainer.
Everything, yes. Say, I put it in this way. Suppose as a trainer going to the automobile industry to give a deliver automobile, you know, people, like, they're working, they expect examples from their industry. Suppose a pharma trainer is going there and he was delivering what a trainings or modules as pharma, he expects pharma kind of a, so domain expertise is kind of a one of the competency every trainer must have and keep on improving that. So if I look at bigger picture, a trainer futuristic is understanding the domain where he was actually supposed to deliver trainings or whatever his, you know, other things, like he has to be expertise to meet the trainers or learners, whatever, like, you know, in the organization. So this is one area they look at it, and the mastering the at least not mastering, it's a profession in terms of, you know, handling the webinars or kind of an online kind of a courses, like. And another thing he also look at, like, you know, snippets. Like nowadays, actually, if you look at, people are likes TikTok and something like, you know, short videos, 3 minutes, 4 minutes, 5 minutes videos. People don't have time to spend too much time on these. So
even for that also.
Even for that also, that's a future. That's a future. Right. Like, I'm not saying that it's currently, it may not, but suppose if you want to make a...
Very true, yes.
If you want to make a decision making, is you are wanted to message, give decision making, it gives you 3 minutes or 5 minutes decision making. Give an example, given a kind of a connecting with the social network, audio, video, whatever relevant, give that. That impacts much more, you know, than the if you give a 1, 2, or 6 hours or 4 hours session. So those kind of things are people are expecting. And they expect, you know, off-shelf, you know, kind of a courses. Like, I'm doing some job, I require certain competencies, I'll immediately Google it. So I just get these, whatever I want. So the trainers must, you know, prepare one thing, domain expertise. Second thing, whatever the examples or other things they're using, it should be more relevant. So because in this situation, the customer is actually changing very fast. Information floating everywhere. So whatever I saw the video 1 month before, it is going to be, you know, I think it's absolute no. So he has to be more, you know, kind of innovative in terms of latest trends in the happening. So those kind of things needs to be possessed. So this is how I look at it, maybe next 3 to 4 years for the, like, you know, trainers.
Wonderful, Ramesh. So what in the summary is, what I understand is that every training professional need to first upskill himself.
Yes. Yes.
On various areas.
Yes.
So when we are talking about the competencies of the employees, and the trainers are nowhere different from any employee of the organization, he also need to understand what are the competencies required and he need to improve. Let's talk more on what competencies, in fact, the trainers need to focus. Before that, let me just go to GR. GR, what's your reflection on this? Unmute yourself, please.
Yeah, Ram, just for my sake, can you just repeat the question?
Yeah. No, how do you reflect, in fact, when we understand competencies now, how the reworking is happening on competencies? People are revisiting their competencies. What are the new competencies that you have observed in the market which are in demand?
Ram, I think I have... I lost touch with competencies and definition and all that. Of course, we do a lot of consulting on that. That's a part. But, you know, actually, let me just focus on
let me just ask you in your language.
In my language. So, okay. So, you know,
what are the new jobs in demand?
Yeah. So, I think the new jobs are going to be more, as I think you are also saying, actually, is a multi-task and multi-responsibility roles. There is no longer a fixed thing. Again, my reference goes to the small, mid-sized enterprises, because when you become large enterprise, you have to be more organized and standardized. And that is why, you know, all your HR jargon of a job description and, you know, all that comes in. But, you know, as you go down in the pyramid, even though it is actually a much larger number of people who are employed in the country, I think it is more about a flexible role responsibilities, and it is keep changing. You know, my understanding of 18 years, you know, living, breathing and eating, sleeping with MSMEs, the employees that I see is that the role that the role that I have written, people have never followed, because it is keeps changing so much, you know, in a smaller company, because their identification of skill and the expertise is done very quickly. There is no HR manager, you know, who's given an opportunity to do a training need analysis, you know, training analysis, nothing, you know, because It is spotted on the ground and then, you know, immediately given an opportunity. There is no gap between identification to the thing. And also, if somebody shows a potential, you know, it's immediately taken into account. You know, it is not that there is going to be any time gap between the identification.
Appraisals time. You need not wait until appraisals time.
Appraisals don't work in MSMEs. That's what my other, you know, all fundamentals of HR I actually lost for the first 10 years. I followed all the HR jargon, you know, which is actually implemented. Then I found that none of these things work the way that we were taught and none of the way that we actually implemented. So it is actually an everyday an appraisal and everyday a demotion, everyday a promotion. You know, it happens just real time. Okay. I think
so. What I understand is agility is very high there.
Extremely high, and the flexibility and the growth is much faster with employees as they improve their capacity. So the flexibility and the openness to learning new things is the only competency, if you ask me, which works there. Rest everything is, you know, supported because everybody is handholding. There we are not taking time to train somebody, right? It is like you know, on the job, you are actually on the job. Somebody is actually, you know, helping you with. Just to Ram, when I'm talking about, you know, further, I would like to just talk about a characteristics of the MSMEs, just for the sake of our, you know, our partners, because it is very important, because more than, you know, 40% of the employment, organized employment is in MSMEs. And I think as a trainers, that's one of the biggest, largest pool. So I just wanted to say that the characteristics of MSME organizations, just for a definition, they are small, they're beautiful, they're cohesive, you know, because everybody knows each one of them knows, you know, each one, and also the family. Maybe in a large company, we had to do an effort to introduce a family, but here you don't need. They're cohesive and very collaborative, okay? And one of the most important things, they're all close to the business. That means that you ask anybody, probably, they may not articulate in a way that you want, but they know exactly how they are actually making an impact. The role that they are playing is actually known to them. The faster decision making, you know, this is one of the very key, you know, aspect of an MSME when I talk about. And impact can be seen very fast in terms of any implementation. That's one. And of course, one, you know, for the sake of all our trainers, cost conscious. But I have seen traditionally, my experience, the family run businesses have actually given more money for the value that we have driven than the professionally run companies, which we assume. You know, this is an indication for all the, you know, trainers who are on the call. So I'm actually referring to the business opportunity for the trainers who are on the call or who are watching us live. And that's what I'm referring to. So these are the characteristics, Ram. Based on that, I'm going to talk about. So anything I'm going to talk about is on these characteristics.
So wonderful. Let me get the clue from your definition of MSME. Can we consider this training consultants, those who are into the training business, as an individual MSME identity?
Yeah. So every individual trainer is called a micro business, right? It's like a proprietary, right? One of the important aspect that two things that I really wanted to share here is that I see that trainers community, I don't know whether it's an ego or whatever, but they are actually two individual experts. I mean, no doubt about it. But when it comes to business, they don't collaborate, right? And my objective always is that, you know, if you are a trainer or an independent consultant or whatever, unless you collaborate, you perish. You perish only when you exhaust your connections. And after that, you don't get anything. Okay, so I think that's one thing, Ram. I feel that the trainers really need to come together and collaborate with like-minded companies, not just necessary in training. I think that is very important when I'm referring to. It has to be with the other HR companies, other HR consultant, because you never know where your competency can be collaborated with the rest of them. And that's what gives them a longevity of employment. I'm just referring as an employment because Venu has referred one of the first characteristic of you know, business in training. So why they lack is because of, I think, is a collaborativeness, I feel, Ram. And also, their one of the biggest mistakes that they make is they go and pester, I would say, use the word, to a large enterprises where they think they can get actually more money or maybe, you know, at one go, you know, they'll actually get a longer duration programs and all that. I think which is totally wrong, because if you lose one, you lose 90% of your business. As a business owner, individual or whatever it is, you must have a very balance of risk portfolio in your thing. So my suggestion is to really seriously look at that, collaborate with others.
Wonderful.
So I think the future is also going to be, it's not necessary that you are just a trainer, but when you reach out to somebody, can you collaborate other services and support system to that company, so that actually, you know, it becomes more, you know, easier for them to not just on revenue on training RAM. I would not look at that training revenue plus. So I think it is very important for a survival to be able to go to the next level. So these are my some few thoughts just on the initial stages of.
Yeah, thanks. There are wonderful inputs you have given for an external training consultants, because they need to collaborate is one. Second thing is that they need to have a risk portfolio. It's a very interesting thing. And please don't rely on only few clients or few customers. Suddenly when they are lost, and your 90% of the business is lost. And let us also see that what kind of not only the characteristics, but also the competencies or the skill sets that they need to improve. And let me just ask Mr. Ramesh, training we are talking about, what is the future for coaching in this situation? Is there any scope, brighter scope? For example, let me just tell you, in India, every organization speak about a coaching a lot. Everybody will speak about coaching, and officially from the organizations, budgets for coaching, I have not seen any organization is dedicating their budgets for coaching. And there are many coaches developing. We see now many consultants are coming with a coaching background, either life coaching or an executive coaching. And how is the future? Is there any chance now because of this situation? You have to unmute your mic, Ramesh. We did not hear. You need to repeat again.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. Pertaining to the coaching, actually, I have a little bit of, you know, kind of a negative word, like, you know, in the bigger sense, actually, organizations now post COVID, first priority would be the stabilize the business. That's if I look at like Venu's words, like entrepreneurship, like what organization owner thinks. So he wanted to first establish existing business and establish the financial flow. Like what would be my, actually every organization does have their business, like budgets. Like, so, sorry, am I audible now? Hello?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yes. You are audible, Ramesh. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So financial budgets, actually they have to relook in terms of what the budgets they're supposed to allocate to which category. So it comes to even for our training and development, will also budgets will be a little bit shrunk this year, probably. Pertaining to the coaching is actually, I agree with some of the points, like, you know, it's not given a proper thought for the even bigger organization, even few organization given that, but they want to do it internally, kind of, you know, cross-functional people who have expertise in a different field, try to understand the business of their own. So they wanted to have them as a coach to their, you know, people. Like, so
you want to say domain expertise?
Yes, domain expertise. Like, for example, a production guy, a senior guy, like, you know, he can coach a sales guy. So he can give the, you know, expertise, like, you know, in terms of their own domain. So that was like little bit started in the bigger companies, like, you know, rather than the executive coach and, you know, getting people from outside. And they really look at the ROA side, return on investment side. I think they won't get a satisfied answers in terms of coaching. So they're more on trainings and, you know, like, you know, guest lectures. So those kind of things are pretty much okay. But in terms of coaching, I think they need to be actually, you know, still they need to do a little more. Yeah, in the organization front. Yeah.
So, Ram, I have a few questions here. So, because behalf of all the training fraternity and coaches, so now the situation post COVID, It is social distancing, and again, online training is flooded for the last 2 months. I think more jnan than the action. So one of my friend says that I think now we all know what to do, but we forgot to actually do any work because we have learned to listen all the 2 months and minds are full. So I think when the knowledge is full, I think whether what is the future of these trainers, because companies, whether they prefer any technical training now, whether they prefer any leadership training or coaches, because I feel coaches are mentors who are actually with a domain expertise, who has got a lot of expertise, may help an entrepreneur. So, but with the organizations, do you have any budget for training, or do you have any plan for the next quarter or 2 quarters to organize any training programs? Are only online events? If it is online events, how the trainers or coaches should transform themselves, and what kind of services solutions should they offer so that you'll start paying them? Otherwise, if there is no business for next 2 quarters, it's difficult to survive because they are not in villages, nor they have a white car, so and they can't migrate. So they must definitely look for an alternative in revenue sources. So because everybody has a compassion for a daily wage worker or an employee, but these are self-employed professionals who are passionate, who actually make a difference to others. If they are not motivated, because when there's no income, they are not motivated, and there's no motivated to motivate a motivator. So I want really a genuine answer. If there's a business, yes. If there's no business, there's no business for next 1 quarter, 2 quarter, or we have already developed coaches inside. We also paid money and made our leaders as coaches, our mentors, or because I have seen in Ultra Tech Cement, there's an Arjuna Drona concept. In Hyundai also, there's a lot of coaching and mentoring is happening. And so you're out of business. We have enough knowledge now. In fact, you want any training and coaching outside, and we will come and give it to you. So if that is the fact, I want as a HR leaders, Ram, that GR and Ramesh Garu really throw some light so that we will look at some other professions where we can survive and thrive. Yes, sir, it's all to you.
I would like to respond on this, Venu. See, any kind of recession or any kind of this kind of events happen, the first industry or first department which gets hit is training. Training is always given a backseat. See, now you said about the future. It is a bold statement to say that there is no business. But it is always a statement anytime that you can make it is that there is no business for those who did not update themselves.
Yeah.
Who did not upskill themselves. No business for any time. And those who are real consultant in the sense, it's not just training and coaches. See, I'll tell you what training is. Most of the times people think training is coming and giving either personality development, behavioral area, attitudinal area, giving training is the training. Now I'm telling you, as Mr. Ramesh said, now every organization is focusing on stabilizing their business. Now what they want is that people, those who can train on the new skill set, that is new technical skills, they require, they are in demand. Yes. If you are a consultant who can train them or educate them, or if you are a coach and help the CEOs of the organizations to tell how can he change the business model, you have a business. And you are a trainer and consultant, if you go, you are going to help the organizations how to reduce their budgets, but still you can train every employee through digital mode, providing all the technical capabilities and logistics, and you are the best consultant and you are in demand. So people are in demand and people have got business, provided you should have a skill set. I am telling you, the trainers, external trainers, those who are depending on the only talk training, only speech training, and now they need to hold on, because now organizations are not looking for them. And yes, of course, motivation. Organizations themselves are giving motivating, because they know their vision, they know their values, and they are motivating their employees with their values. And now every employee requires the motivation of an assurance of a job, assurance of a learning new competencies in the same environment. That is what is the motivation they require. Now, if any coaches are there, training consultants are there, you should not be a consultant to deliver a training. You should be a consultant overall for the organization development. How a training strategy can be changed, how your thinking pattern can be changed, but with a reduced budget, still objectives are met. These kind of ideas, if you have, and you go present to the organization, you are in a great demand. In fact, they require you. A lot of e-learning platforms are coming. Every day, we are getting calls from the new LMS platforms, e-learnings, content developers. These are all the things. Now, individually, let me also tell one more thing. What are the other skills that trainers need to develop if they want to have a business? People need to be technically very smart. For example, I'll tell you, you know very well, Venu, because you're conducting a lot of webinars. And people, though they are in a very senior position since long, they do not know how to operate their camera. They do not know most of the times to handle the crisis when their audio is lost. For example, you look at it, I'm live example I'm giving, you look at GR's background is just updated. He say that he worked on it. And if a trainer is giving a large training program, suddenly audio is lost, power is lost, he doesn't know how to manage, and your skills are not enough. So what you require is, see how you are online, you learn on the job. See, this is how it is. So I'm saying, and people need to be technically smart. And now, external consultants, all the training halls are going to become studios. Now, 50% of the training rooms are going to become studios. Technically, you need to be sound. And every freelancers, you have to make your drawing room a studio where you will have all the camera, audio, lighting, everything. You need to have complete understanding about that. And these capabilities you need to improve. Unless you have this, you cannot just consult an organization saying that I'm a consultant, now I will give training through webinars. Same speech, but only through webinar is not at all enough. That will not touch the heart of any vendor to give you a business. You need to have more skills. That's what you need to understand. Disruption is there. Diversity is there. What diversity? It's not only a delivery. It is also, you need to have all the logistics knowledge of the technical webinars that you conduct. Also, you develop a domain expertise. For example, if I am consulting an auto industry, then I would like to train your people. You need to know what is SOP, what is GMP, what is regulatory norms, and what are the challenges, what are the auditings. If you do not know all those things, and you are obsolete as a trainer, and you will be extinct from the training industry. And I'm telling you, just personality development and motivation is not going to work. It is only always should be clubbed with something, a domain expertise, also precise talent that you have. This is what is my take, Venu. Maybe others can respond.
Wonderful, Ram. So it is now GR and Ramesh Garu to give their view.
Yeah, thank you, Venu. We've been talking about globalization and all that, but one thing that I found our trainers, especially the training community, how many of them really look at global view? Why do you really need to look at the area or the location that you are stuck to? You know, I think it has to be a global view going forward. That's my first scent, because of technology, you can deliver from anywhere, right? That's take that as an advantage. If not here, somewhere across the globe, people do need. I mean, I have literally seen just English speaking. Like today, we are actually doing it in English. But if you see the same thing, any part of the Europe when you go, or any other countries that you go, they do it in a local language. Probably this would have been Hindi, if that is the case. But I think English is something that is going to be very universal, and people are really willing to learn in English, you know, as such. So I think, you know, when you are actually, when you know English as a language, you know, why should you look at only India as a boundary? That's the first thing that I have. And also the second thing that I would like to now draw you back onto the MSMEs as an opportunity. I will only focus on the business opportunity. I will not talk about the competencies. You all have competencies, but just that you have to map yourself with the need and you know, how you can actually make more business where it needed most. That's how I look at it. India has the largest MSME economy, and government, you know, is also looking at that. And also there's a ministry for MSME, etc. And also there's a revised definition of MSMEs right now. So one of the biggest challenge, if you ask me, in the future, their survival is based on only one factor, is preparing their second line leadership, which typically would have been grown by looking at the business owner. So that means they are just like, you know, the same person, and they try to be like the business owner. I think this is where one of the biggest challenge that I see, and the biggest opportunity where the future money is going to be spent by the MSMEs in the country. It is most critical. What is that you need to train them? It is not that you're going to go and, you know, sit with them and you know, help them to train the trainer or whatever it is. No way. I think the future is going to be how, because most of the organizations today have Gen Z or a millennials, right? These are the only two generations that we have. And if the manager is in any of these categories, probably I think they need to be helped. Not that they need to be trained. They need to be helped to actually help their teams. I think I feel that is going to be the biggest opportunity as a trainer. You know, don't look at, you know, 20 people to do. In a small company, 2-3 people, you kind of do a kind of a support to them. That's going to help a lot. And I see that the business owners are willing to invest on the second line leadership, because, you know, for them, survival is important. And so for survival, who knows the business is very important. So second line knows the business, but they don't know how to really take them to the next level. I think that's one of the largest opportunity that you need to really invest from today. That's my scent. And also one is globalization. The other is internally MSMEs, the second line leadership. Focus on that, create some programs and help them. It's a blended programs, not necessarily as Ram was saying, you know, ek hi kaam nahi karega. So you have to actually literally have a, you know, combination. And also, how do you help the employees learn on their own? I think that is going to be one of the biggest thing that one need to really help them right now, because nobody needs, you know, they don't have an attention span.
Self-paced learning.
Yeah, self-paced only. And then how do you help them? I think that is going to be more as a critical skill than actually they're learning and all, you know, we having a skill. I think that's going to be, I feel, the biggest challenge. The other opportunity that I see is that why do you have to look at only companies to pay? There are people who value your expertise, and they are now started willing. I mean, 15 years back, 10 years back, 5 years back, people were not willing to spend money for their own development. Today, because nobody is going to wait for a company to invest. So I think there is one opportunity there for sure. In line with that, which I would like to really talk about, is the biggest future opportunity that is going to come up, especially in India at least, is that there is a lot of workers who are gig workers who are going to work for many international organizations delivering, you know, services to them. I think they are the biggest opportunity of the future. You know, we talk about gig working, gig economy, but when gig economy is happening, how are our trainers are ready actually to help them? You know, in fact, even if one or two people are there, maybe it will be more a person to person, one to one driven, maybe, or online. And especially the international companies don't expect you to come, you know, physically and deliver, unlike in India. Of course, now with COVID, probably we also learned, but, you know, we start negotiating on money, which is actually the problem. So just ignore for some time, because, you know, you need to find opportunities where the value, what you bring in, should be respected, and don't do it free of cost. The other day I was actually running a poll on LinkedIn just to say that, hey, you know, if a LinkedIn workshop is done for about 3 hours, would you pay for it? And 85% of them say free, right? But there are 1-2% who actually said yes, right? I think it is how you actually reach out to them is very important. So one thing that I would like to really say here, why they don't get an opportunity or they don't get recognized so much, is that they don't give. They always look for, can you give? You know, when you say, when you are in the market, when you are on the internet space, when you're saying always, hey, this is a program I offer, you know, take it. Nobody's going to come to you. But when you say that you're continuously giving, right, in a network, when you give, only you get. Otherwise, you don't get anything. So I think that is one of the biggest lessons that the trainers, coaches have to do it, that, you know, they have to constantly give. See, give something which will start selling your services when you are sleeping, right? You know, probably this video, what we have done, after we go to sleep, it will come, right? It will, people will look into it. Ram, yeah, sorry.
Yeah, adding value.
Yeah, you have to keep adding value, because, and also it is not one day activity. You know, you have to continuously do it. Then you create your personal brand. And then one of the most important thing is today, how many trainers are discoverable beyond their own network? I think that's a biggest lesson that they have to learn to capture the domestic and international global opportunities that they can deliver sitting at home.
Beautiful, GR. So I think great insights given by each one of you, and especially GR. So that particularly MSME second line leadership, and also grow global. So because once you know English, that's enough. Because many trainers in countries like America, not from USA. So it's at the end of the day, what context and content you deliver, rather than what accent you have. So wonderful. Thank you, Gia. So also, the business is, when you are sleeping, it should work. So there is a one beautiful platform called SSO Teachable. I see a lot of trainers are keeping their courses there. Anybody also can keep there. Suppose you can run a webinar. I did last month 2 webinars I run, 21-day program and 10-day program, and people have paid money. But I don't know whether they'll pay now, because a lockdown period is an opportunity and an investment. And from tomorrow onwards, I have announced, and let me tell you that, so not many registrations now. I understand that people are in and run now. So I need to change my strategy. So what I'm doing the next 1 week, I wanted to convert all the recorded my webinars into a sellable course and keep it in a platform called SSO Teachable, or something, a platform where another company is ready to create a platform for me, where they want to work on something like 70-30 ratio. They will not charge me much, but they'll take percentage on the sales that happens. And that's called gig economy. Today we are talking, we are paid on the performance. So in if you really have stuff, you can sell your courses, and you can start giving your sessions free. But you can tell them every time that you have a session available online, and 100% money back guarantee. That's what I want to keep, because I'm sure that nobody will ask the money after my program. So, and these are the things I'm developing. So I really want to ask you a few questions, that how come some people make more money online also creating like a company? So because how they transform from an individual to a company, because I see a lot of, because America, the after singers, speakers make more money. There are millionaires, there are billionaires. Why not in India? Why only few names? So what is the difference in mindset here? Because our Bhagavad Gita, all big jnan, spiritual gurus give everything free, and they also became motivational speakers. And in fact, our prime minister also a great motivational speaker. I think the sellability of these motivation is lost. It is no more there. And the training, of course, people want a specific training, like a construction. They want a machine training. They want a plumbing training. So some companies require these technical people, but they are not available. So those kind of the skills require training. Maybe a public speaking training is needed, but you can't give a virtual, you can't give a physical training today. Only virtual training may be possible. So training is limited to a skill set. And where is the coaching? Of course, life coaching and professional coaching, they are two different sectors. So I feel business coaching and life coaching, I don't know that how much you can scale, because I always look at the scale, whether there's a possibility to scale the business. So, and the business coaching, definitely, as JR said, in MSME, because big organizations may not need you, and they'll have entrepreneurs like Ramesh and Ram Jaldurgam within the organization. So they are the superheroes of the organization. Obviously, they know more about their company than we know. So I think they can relate the context and the situational wisdom. So obviously, they are preferred. So whereas for small entrepreneurs and MSME entrepreneurs, you are the hero. Your wisdom helps. Your mentoring helps. So you have to actually help them get results, not just I given a session. I think this mindset should go. I given 1 hour session or half day session or 3 hour session, and you are paid based on the time. This mindset has to go from this profession. That's what I honestly feel, because I have been helping some of my clients in this during lock period, lockdown time, not asked any money from any one of them. So they only paid me. They only wanted to offer me, because I'll tell you, once you start giving, nature is such a beautiful thing. It will not keep it. It will be feel obligated. It will give you one or other way. That is for sure. So at this point of time, try to help. That's what I say, that business has got only 2 points, either solve a problem or serve a need. So I think you must do both. So once we have something, I started giving. I think everybody has seen it, and even including this program. So to help, because I wanted to bring in a lot of these panel discussions every week and different professions. Maybe next one is about psychologist and Ram Jaldurgam, since he's also into that, want you to lead these programs. And whenever you feel relevant, I want you to please come, so that your insights, since one-to-one, this I think synergy is more when we have a panel discussion. So yes, sir, so that's, I already spoke a lot, because of dominant speaker in me, it is difficult to stop for myself. Thank you so much for a valuable contribution. It's over to you, Ram.
Yeah, Venu, things what you highlighted is a true fact. We can't deny them. So on this, I think Ramesh has got his own opinion, and let him also share how he reflects on it.
I think, you know, I'll put it this way. Actually, bigger organization in India is very a small number. Okay, in a bigger sense, like, you know, MSMEs is much more larger. So there is a high potential for the trainers, even for a coaches, like all the training professional, you know, expertise. So there is a requirement. There is a requirement for a MSME industry. And with respect to the larger organizations, yes, they're developing internally, making them, you know, and coming back to, is it professional or business? Like, I think even for a bigger organization, they look at around, like, you know, business model only, rather than the, you know, giving of free of cost and other things, like, you know, they look at, you know, comprehensive package, right from the content development to understanding their values, and content development, delivery, effectiveness. So those kind of things, you know, companies are looking at. Those people are having this kind of entire comprehensive kind of a, you know, system, then they can very well, like, you know, welcome. Yeah.
And when you asked, is there any future for training profession? There is one more role is there in demand. I just wanted to tell an external consultants, they can even try. If they can find a way to give an ROI to the organizations, how to calculate ROI, or how to get ROI from the efforts that organization is into. For example, if they propose any e-learning programs or anything, they have to show evidence, or they will have to give tangible benefits to the organizations where the calculation is a crystal clear, then the organization can see value and ROI, so that they will give this business consultancy to that consultant or a trainer. So that is one role, and that is one competency that people need to have. If they have, then demand, particularly pandemic time, anything that you spend, and you need to show that calculation abilities, or you need to have an intelligence of what are the factors to consider to calculate this ROI. So this is one. And coaches, see, most of the times, and coaching is also a discussion here. See, coaches cannot get a business just by qualification. It is like, you know, you want to get a job as an artist, but you have 4 certificates as an artist, you cannot become an artist. With just one stroke, they will decide whether you are an artist or not. It is not the certificates which will sell you, or which is not a qualification which will sell you. A The people, those who gain qualification, is that by your achievement. The achievement is that, are you an entrepreneur? Are you a brand leader? Do you have a personal branding? And have you seen life to become a life coach? So these are all very, very important. Now organizations, more than a life coach, I'm saying, because now organizations are not expecting any employee to work with them for a lifetime. So for their growth, organizations, as I say, MSMEs, what they, GR rightly said, that what they want now, they are going to now adopt or hire consultants and finish the program. And they will not have any strategy for the future vision and all. Second thing, today biggest challenge for a trainer or a consultant is just because learners are preferring self-paced. In fact, nobody has got a patience to sit in a classroom for 8 hours and learn. They need not also. Social media is open and everybody can access any information. If they want to learn something, right now I can access something and learn something. And a trainer need not come. You need not schedule a date. I need not sit in the classroom. All those things are all gone. And now what they want is that they want a flexibility, a liberty to learn something. And you offer as an organization training program, at my free time I learn. And most of the times current generation is learning from 12 a.m. in the midnight. So no trainer can reach them at that time and train them. So these flexibilities and these dynamics of the present generation, you need to understand and then deliver the solutions rather than just a training. Training is not a solution, complete solution. Training is one of the approaches that you have. It is one of the performance improvement intervention, even if you give a technical training program. There are many approaches, many dimensions are there. You need to thoroughly aware of those interventions and dimensions.
Wonderful, Ram. So GR has something to share here. And also welcome Sri Anjigar for joining this session. Thanks a lot for adding value. And GR, please go ahead.
Okay, so one other thing that I would like to really talk about, the technology pace of work.
Anjigaru trying to speak and Anjigaru meer inka mute lo unnaru mimmalni unmute chesamu GR tarvata you please take over sir so GR is sharing something yes GR please go.
Okay so one of the very most important thing you know always the trainers lack or is the information about the employees and you know what they really know because unless they go and ask that okay, what is your problem? You know, how do I solve and all that? But more than that, if you are able to work with certain tools, not necessary for the training tools, you know, I'm just saying that, you know, you work with, there are a lot of international companies or globally, there are so many companies who are actually providing training tools intelligence, okay? So which are actually imbibed into the organization. So one of the things that you may want to really do is collaborate with not the I would always go back and say not the ones which are known to everybody. Probably the unknown tools that are built, let's say somewhere in California or maybe, you know, in Russia or anywhere, some of the tools are so intelligent that you can actually help them to penetrate into the market first. And don't look at that, would you get a business or not? But you need to have an intelligence about the business. That is one factor. There's a millions and billions of dollars are spent in actually investing on a startups area. The other is why I said the earlier wise collaborate with other, you know, HR companies or HR IS companies, you know, the partner, because once you actually help them to implement an HR package, let's say in a small enterprise, you actually know the entire details of the company because, you know, it is an intelligence about, you know, what is what kind of people are there? What can be really proposed? Because most of the times what you lack is the gatekeeper called HR person, typically, who actually gives an information or don't give an information, right? So this way you can actually make sure that your tools which are given, whether it's free of cost, short term, long term, or whatever it is, but you're actually investing your time and creating a pipeline of a spectrum, like, you know, how every telecom companies work. It is like a spectrum. You actually imbibe into it and, you know, you actually use the, you know, bandwidth kind of a thing. So this is very, very, you know, important thing that I see that try and find not just only a learning modules that you go and, you know, sell and implement, But look beyond that, all the HR related technology tools, can you collaborate with all of them across the globe is one factor. Venu, one more thing before I forget, you know, that I would like to really also say is that, see, none of us are going to become rich by actually everyday money or being an employee. Ever we become a rich, you know, until we actually create wealth by actually having a share of a company, share of this thing, right? What I foresee is that the trainers have a great opportunity to work with the startup enterprises. And instead of actually asking for money, you know, maybe they could use some into a turning out into an equity. And let me tell you that all of you that Ministry of Corporate Affairs is going to make sure that all the shares of any small company also will be dematerialized in the future, not just only the listed companies. So hence, the moment it's dematerialized, it becomes easy to transact, you know, share. So instead of monetary, there could be a balance of equity versus the delivery so that you are actually growing with them. Just imagine, you know, you work with five companies today, you don't get more money, but you know, out of five, one makes it big, you know, into the future, you create a lot of wealth. So I feel that you need to focus on collaborating and creating an organizations together. So this is an idea for my friends. And most of the MSMEs and startups are willing to look at that because they can't spend money immediately, but I think this is a great opportunity that I foresee in the future. Thank you, Venu.
New business opportunity you offered, in fact, that's a great idea also you have thrown, JR, very good. Consultants may really use this platform thanks to Venu. Probably you are helping also consultants how they can look at their profession and what are the other opportunities that they can look at. We have a new guest, Venu. Yes, we can invite him.
Wonderful, Ram. In fact, it is big organization and a little larger or above medium size will not give this opportunity. It is only a small growing entrepreneur will give this. That is very important, GR. So the big
organization
use your talent and pay you some money and get rid of you. I'm telling you, may praise you a lot. They may call you a guru. But they will only give you, and as I always say, that tapatlo, dupatlo, these two will be given by the biggies always. But the real sharing and recognizing and make you a shareholder is the growing entrepreneur. So it is always to help somebody who has the
It's problem. Always B Club.
Yeah, it's so always
it like
B Club is meant for them. I bring these biggies to help the a growing entrepreneur. So my love is for there's a medium and small, but this their mind should not be small. Business can be a small. This is what my intention always. Yes, Ram. So our friend Anjay also, Mr. Sri Anjay Gar also joined. So Ram, please take care. Ram, you are mute. Please unmute.
Anjay Gar, I think you must be tracking or getting the views of the speakers, panel speakers here. Definitely, you must have come with some central idea or central message that you wanted to communicate on this platform. We would like to listen to you.
So, thank you, sir. Are you able to hear me, sir?
Yes, Sanjay Gar.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes, sir. First of all, sorry, I joined lately due to my personal reasons. Sir, regarding this, this is a very good concept and very good right point as taken by our Venu Bhagwan sir to communicate the total, especially this paternity, what is the training of this provide and all. It is really, sir, it is even if we can see the manufacturing units especially, if the training concept is entire changed now, the actually people are looking. In spite of somebody is calling and providing the training inside, either he can utilize his own own way of like internally, or otherwise make the one on me. You can see the hero is concerned on how it would be. Hero is having his own concept of the training. That's called as a gurukul, where each and every unit having a gurukul. It is the whole. It has to be led by their own technical and one behavioral guys. And we are all coming into the system. First 15 days should go through the all type of the training, all type of the culture of the hero and take it to forward. The similar ways of the concept of the training also now entire changed compared to if you can see the 5 years back, the concept of the training and utilization, today training and utilization is an entire change. The people, especially this manufacturing sector, is looking ready-made product like a full trained person needed to utilize them. Not for the, okay, we can hire and later trial, later use. The type of the things is changing. Hello.
Yeah, Anjayar, it is audible. Ram, can you hear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So in my point of view, sir, the present scenario, if we can see the observations of the training pattern changes, even you means the I request I requested Venubhagwan sir also. Sir, today even automobile sector or pharma sector based on the Hyderabad automobile sector either Chennai or here, they're looking the person, they really needed a talented guys. But whereas the if you can see the ITIs or some other plus two or these bottom guys, their skill level is very, very low. Like you take the plumbers, you take the some other mechanics, some other welders. If it is just, they are just their only certificate only having. If you can find out the worker, means their quality of work as a, even diploma guys also, their level of contribution, their level of knowledge is, we can consider as a like 30-35%. Able to, we can focus on such a, means especially young generation, able to capture them and provide a appropriate training for them to what is the need of the industries. Even it's going to be more useful for the industries, can use ready-madely, it is going to be help for the vice versa, sir. It's a win-win situation. That is my feeling.
Thank you, Anjay Garu. In fact, very good. Again, your reflection added one more dimension and more value to this discussion. So, Venu, in fact, since we have come more than an hour back, there are a lot of consultants or the trainers are all in the platform, in our forum. They are directly listening and many people are indirectly listening to us. And I want people, those who are on this platform, who can ask questions. Maybe we can open that question and answer session before we conclude if they have any specific questions or to any specific panel members. What do you say, Venu?
Yes, Ram. So, in fact, they can raise hands so we can unmute them or they can type the question so that I'll unmute them so that they can ask. There are a lot of people are watching in Facebook Live also, like Challa Ram Fanigaru. So, they're all happy for the inputs they have given. They are thankful to Ramesh Garu.
What is the number, Venu, for our understanding?
Yeah, the reach number I can see is about 30 there. But the post reach is about 5,600 till now. So that is a measure I can see. And I think 30 plus here about 16 and inclusive of all of us, about 46 are actively watching this program. I think this will because our digital marketing, Mr. Vamsi is sharing to a lot of groups. 56 shares are there. I don't know whether our person shared or anybody shared on themselves. 56 sharings are there. So it has reached about 5,600. I'm sure that next 2 days it will reach beyond a 10,000 or fraternity and anybody, because there must be some people who are willing to become a trainer, willing to become a coach. They might have done a professional program or they have done a train the trainer program. So they may be 1-2 years senior into this program. So they must be having a lot of ambitions. So because this is an inspiring field, whether you get money or not, you get kick every time you deliver a session. So like any drug, this is also a kind of an addiction, because I'm also a beneficiary and victim of this. So that is the reason I want people to be normal. Anybody says I'm motivated with your speech, I really get frightened and what kind of decisions you will take and how it will impact their life. So I have been very cautious not motivating anybody for the last few years. It is only seeing that what's possible for them based on their potential, because each one has got a unique potential and they must understand their strengths and do accordingly. And particularly develop a business model, being a speaker or a trainer or a coach, don't be an individual anymore. If you are a doctor, you have to have a business model. And otherwise, being a self-employed is the most insecure thing. Being an employee is far better than being a self-employed. That is the reason. So I wanted this platform so that they understand the truth. So Ram said bluntly that there's no business unless you are specialist comes with a specific niche area. Ramesh said that next two quarters we are focusing on our business. And Ajigar said that how technical training has become cheap. Earlier it was 12,000 safety training, Six Sigma and other trainings. Now they are doing it for 2,000. In fact, I have reduced my fees for a corporate minimum. My fees, you can see in my website. Last year, we have developed a website with the help of my friend Ram Kishore. That boldly I kept all my prices. If somebody wants to call me per minute, 100 rupees minimum, 30 minutes, and you should tell the purpose, then only we will give our account details. For everything, there is a price. So because the profession, the name has derived from the first profession called, maybe it's called prostitution. So the sales actually started from there. And if you are a professional, you must sell yourself. So, and I have boldly kept all my prices. I'm a professional and I'm proud to say I'm an entrepreneur. I started a bold B Club and I have organized events. I collaborated with people. So definitely today I'm an entrepreneur. I was an entrepreneur, but this field, I became a self-employed and I struggled a lot. And when I became an entrepreneur, again, I'm telling you, I'm thriving, my dear friend, not surviving. That's the reason I want this message from every one of your leader, because you are HR leaders, so that you know much higher, much better than what is actually going on in the corporate world. So people who are looking at organizations, people who are looking at outside, must understand this truth. And really, I think GR has given a new, you opened a new market, 6.5 million. That means 6.5 crore. If small, medium entrepreneurs are there, who will serve them? How many mentors are available to them? So you understand your strength, understand your domain, and you can probably useful to a sector. You can serve 100 people, not more than that, one-to-one. So there's so much abundance is available. So the, nobody has to get...
There is one question, Renu.
Yes, sir.
To specifically GR. Mr. Mahesh is asking if the MSME allocates any budgets for trainings to employees and from ministry and any mandate for such activities to conduct.
Yeah, so then
maybe he's asking CSR.
The MSMEs don't allocate any resources for training because actually they don't know that jargon because they haven't done any MBA programs, okay, because they actually started their companies. But what they can do is if they actually see a value, they bring money. You know, how an entrepreneur brings money is beg, borrow or steal, whatever it is, you know, if he has to really get it done. So I think it is always about how do you network with them? How do you ensure that there is a value that you can really deliver for them? The budgets will come. Here, you don't have to wait for a budgets. That's my guarantee. And of course, the
so I feel, I think, schemes,
Ram, a lot of schemes where MSMEs, registered companies actually get some rebates or the return on money, you know, that they invest into the training, etc. There are certain provisions that they would know, definitely. So you don't have to worry too much about it as well.
Maybe what I look at it is that probably these consultants need to develop business cases to go to MSMEs. If you can successfully present that business case where the need is raised, need is sold, then you will get a business.
My this thing, Ram, because there are 66 million MSMEs, that means 6.6 crores at this point of a time, it is humanly not possible and some of them are not discoverable. But the only way you can discover is that fellow HR companies, then HR company who's into recruitment, can be your target. The HR company who's into HR management can be your target. The HR company who's into payroll also can be your target because they already are servicing the client. So it is always easier to actually approach and collaborate with them to go. I don't advise because humanly, for me also, it's not possible. Even though we have an organization, still we can't invest in actually going and hunting. We just have
to physically reach them.
Yeah. So we have to only farm. That is only through a relationships that you know we can have. That is first thing. And the second, of course, as I said, you must be discoverable. When you start giving it on the internet space, you get automatically discovered. I think these two are the things that they should know, Ram.
Now, there's a participant, Mr. Ranjan, has raised his hand. Yes, Mr. Ranjan.
Ram Garu and GR Garu, I have probably a question for both of you. What like I understand this time wouldn't be enough, but what could be a few basic things a trainer or a consultant needs to like focus on while developing a business model as a beginner? What could be the first few things one need to zero in on?
First thing I would say immediately, sorry, Ram, I'm just picking up because I know.
Go ahead, please. Your question.
So I think first, don't do it yourself. That's the first thing that you need to do. And I think you need to collaborate to start at this point of time. You know, that's my first scent. That's it. I think that will actually talk about quite a bit of things that you need to focus on to be a startup. The second is always look at trying to create a wealth than monetary value, you know, for the time that you're spending, because we are in a market where people don't respect time. Unfortunately, that's the truth. So, you know, so you have to really take care of these two.
Wonderful. Ram Garu,
Ranjan, that's a good question. I know, I think you wanted to give this benefit to many consultants watching this, but I just
understand this.
Number one, business acumen. People need to have a good knowledge about the business acumen. For example, when you are approaching an automobile industry or any other organization within pharma or into consultancy, you should know their business thoroughly. Number one. Mm-hmm. Number two, just consultants and trainers are not just trainers. They should be a lot of research behind it. When you do your research and come with a lot of business models you understand, maybe you can create a new business model to propose to your client. So you need to have a domain expertise. Second, year out of your study or research, you need to bring new business models. Then third, as GR exactly said, it is a collaboration. You need to collaborate with others so that what you are proposing to your client is that it's not me alone and we are working together. I'm getting you new competencies, new technologies and new people also into this. And all that collaboration also is very much required. You need to see these three things, Ranjan. I see number one is a domain expertise. The second is that developing, understanding a business cases, then you can develop a business case, a business model. And the third is that collaboration.
Thank you, Ram Garu. Thank you so
just
much.
Just to add Ram there, while Ram referred to you as an individual when you start up, but if you as an organization that you are building, not necessarily just a domain will help. It is to attract the domain specialists is important to build your organization, which creates value for value to you know your customers or clients.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Jiyar.
Sir Ranji gar, you have anything to add here? Sir Ramesh gar, you have to anything add? So because no more questions.
Sir, I agreed with my co-speakers what they have told. Actually, right, they have to identify what is the need, what is the new model. But what is the circumstance? Love is in Varanasi, means is UP. Lot of automobile sector is there. Really, what is the exactly needed for them? So, if that is going to be help, sir. If you can see the lot of models and you can come with the new ideas, which is required at present for the either industry or society. So definitely success will come, sir. And further, I agreed. Yes, it is. In spite of it's going alone, you can collaborate with any team and going, it's going to be helpful, sir.
Thank you, Anjigar. Sir, Ramesh gar, your final message to our training fraternity, including coaches, speakers, and every professional into this.
I also agree with Mr. GR, actually. No, things are actually doesn't actually, those who wanted to do individually doesn't help, actually. As a team, as a, you know, support with the other, you know, HR, you know, organizations. So that will be kind of a starting point. I completely agree with that, Mr. GR's point of view. And my message for the trainers, coaches, actually, there is huge potential. Just look at the pandemic is a short term. And, anyway, companies are actually going to revive whatever phase manner maybe takes maximum 1 year or maybe less than 1 year. And there is a huge potential in the digital era. Industrial Revolution 4.0 is around the corner. So there is a lot of automation is happening and there is a lot of off-shelf programs needed for this, trainers, coaches who are, a fraternity of, this community. Actually, plenty of opportunity. Whether you make money, I think maybe after one and a half year, I may see you as an entrepreneur, like people who are currently listening, coaches, they make money like anything. If they have a potential to deliver and give the programs to the organization, tie up with the it's very open for it gives an opportunities for everyone. So that's what my message to the whoever trainers and coaches. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Wonderful, Ramesh Garu. So it is ma bashla cheppalante, this is very inspiring. Thank you so much so for giving such a future as a bright future for all of us. And I think as you said that industry 4.0, I think we have to be our next version, so best, maybe the best version. I always say that this decade is the last decade for the people who are born in last century, because artificial intelligence will take over, automation will take over, and maybe next generation will take over. So I think this is the last decade, so it's for the next generation to take over after that. So we have the wisdom, we have the experience, we have the experience of success, failure, every sort of thing which is called wisdom. I think we can mentor and guide the present leaders and entrepreneurs, so our community. Thank you for joining, I think, everybody in this Zoom and also in the Facebook. So I also want Ram's final message, as because he's playing the role of a corporate leader as an L&D head in a company where about 10,000 employees are there and where training is a must. And also he's been a coach and also he's been a psychologist and he's been everything in of what you call a human potential development. So your view, Ram, final, your message to the fraternity.
See, my final message is that every consultant need to open their all antennas. You need to be a keen observer. You need to have an eye for details. And then I'll come back to GR's in the beginning advice. You go approach clients to help them not to get a business, because that approach itself will get you business. Because every organization is helping for someone who can help. They're waiting for or expecting someone to come and help. And if you can help with your new approach, or any solution to them, and they are going to include you as their partner. That's my message.
Wonderful, Ram. So thanks for today leading the session and moderating it. So excellent. I'm thankful to you. As my friend and colleague, you always do your best and add value to the events I do. And if I rely on very few people, and Ram Jaldargam is one. And thank you so much for, I think we have a collaboration. So most of the programs we have done together, whenever we have done, it's a great success. I think, JR, we have taken intuitively your advice much before. I think we also collaborated long, long ago, 15 years ago, 10 years ago for an engineering college. I think, thank you, Ramesh Garu, and thank you, Anjay Garu. So I think, JR Garu, is there anything to add?
But what I would like to really say is create a collaborative organization, whether you are paying salaries as an organization or a collaborative where you don't have to pay, but you actually gain a lot more, from collaboration. So collaborative enterprise is what I think the future that one must look at as a trainer today.
Wonderful. So this is a great message at this point of time, not only for the people who are in this session, but it applies to every businessman, every individual, that collaboration is the order of the day. And because next 1 year, or 2 years, things are not going to be the same way like earlier. It will never be the same way if you ask me. The psyche and structure, like my friend Ram Kishore says, is going to permanently transform. I always say one thing, leaders cannot give messages, leaders are the messages. Each one of you have been example of what leader and entrepreneurs. Each one of you have given us your insight, which is valuable. Difficult to get an appointment of Ramesh ji or Anjay garu, so or Ram Jaldurgam, is not easy to get their appointment. But you are given out of heart because you consider this is our family, and let's help the human potential developers who are helping people. Thanks a lot for everyone who is watching this program. Thank you, Ram Jaldurgam, Ramesh garu, JR, and Anjay garu. And
thank you,
our intention of B Club only three things: be bold, stay bold, and play bold.